apologize from speaking from a sitting position, but one thing that comes with elder privilege is the right to do whatever the hell you want to do. And I choose not to stand on my feet for hours to talk to somebody, largely because it hurts. I have nobody to perform for. And I get the right to say, I have worked 45 years of the movement, and I deserve the right to sit on my ass. Okay? And so, but I have to tell all of the young people in the room, do not fear getting old. It brings so many benefits. I've always been an old soul in a young body, but now I'm an old soul in an old body. And I was talking to one of my interns yesterday, and she said, don't call yourself old, don't call yourself old. And I'm like, why not? I earned these warrior marks. I'm very proud of them. Every one of those gray hairs got an intern on it. You know? And so anyway, I'm pleased to be with you. I live in Atlanta, but I spent 20 years in the DC area. I went to Howard University and stayed for 20 years. It's where I developed my consciousness, my radical view of the world was in the riots of DC in 1968, got tear gassed in my dormitory, Meridian Hill, in 1970. And it was really a blessing, I believe, to have developed my feminist consciousness in a place like Washington, D.C., because it was kind of like a hotbed of black feminism. And I met people like Lorraine Hutchins. Hi, Lorraine. And because the reason I call it a blessing is that I was able to develop a radical feminist consciousness in the company of other black women. So it wasn't until 5 or 6 years later, after I'd been grounded in my feminism, that I had to hold my oppositional stance against white women, because that was not my first introduction to feminism. My first introduction to feminism was doing anti-apartheid work, or doing Central American solidarity work, or fighting the gentrification of Washington at the time. We were trying to fight to keep Adams Morgan and Capitol Hill from being gentrified. Obviously, we lost. But in 74, we did pass the first rent control bill in Washington, D.C., so some of you are still benefiting from that, I'm sure, if you live in the city and stuff. But developing feminism under those conditions really didn't allow us to isolate violence against women from other human rights issues that we were concerned about. We didn't even have the word intersectionality at the time, but we were working intersectionally. And I remember challenging my board of directors at the Rape Crisis Center, who didn't understand why we were having a program against apartheid at the Rape Crisis Center. We're like, why not? Why not? I mean, these are the violences that women experience. And the fact that we were actually working with men who were incarcerated down at Lorton, I don't think Lorton is open anymore, but it was where they sent incarcerated people from DC, incarcerated men from DC, because it was gender specific. And I remember being at the Rape Crisis Center, and I got this letter from this man named William Fuller. And William wrote, outside I raped women, inside I'm raping men. I'd like to not be a rapist anymore. And I swear that letter sat around the center for almost 2 years before we responded to him. Because our first response was, we don't even have enough money and resources to help the victims. How dare a perpetrator want some help? That was our first response. And William was persistent, though. He kept recontacting us and recontacting us. And finally, me and a good friend of mine, Nkenji Turay, who's in the hospital now up in Rockville, so send out a shout out and prayer for her. Anyway, got in the car, drove down to Lorton, met with William Fuller, and it's kind of hard to describe that first meeting, and it was my first time going to a prison. So the strip search, which wasn't a full strip search, but a pretty intense search, was a new experience for me. And then when you meet William, he's like 6'6", buffed up like the Hulk. And then in the process of getting to know him, he explained to me the way not to be a victim in prison is to be the baddest, strongest person out there. And so he was religious about his weight training and beefing up his body so that he could be the predator and not the prey. We ended up working with William, starting Prisoners Against Rape, which was the first prisoner-directed program working to end violence. And for us, it wasn't easy, but it also wasn't that hard, because most of sexual assault, as you probably well know, is intra-racial, happening within the same race. And so when you're talking about people who are convicted of sexual assault from the District of Columbia, you're talking about basically black men. And so we were not adverse to figuring out how to develop some kind of conversation with men from our own community who were incarcerated for violating women. And not only women, I should add. One of the more unique things we experienced back in the 70s was that at least, I think, somewhere between 5 and 10% of the people who came to the Rape Crisis Center for help were boys. And this was because there was some kind of bizarre gang ritual where boys were getting raped as part of the jump-in strategy. And so unmarked in all of the lurid newspaper coverage and stereotypes of who gets victimized by sexual assault were an incredibly large number of boys. That when we first came up with the center, we hadn't thought about any protocols for boys. Yeah, we were trying to help the women. We had not thought of originally protocols for LGBT folks. That all came out as we were developing the programs. But I would like to say we had the foresight to anticipate all the people who get brutalized by sexualized violence. We didn't. We started with a hotline, ended up with a program. The program grew. We ended up writing the first rape protocols for hospitals, for the police department, for what used to be LEAA, the Law Enforcement Assistance Administration, which is now the Department of Justice. We were carving a path where no one had gone before, because the DC Rape Crisis Center, I don't think I said this, was the first one in the country. So we had friends in New York who founded NYWAR, New York Women Against Rape, and there were SFWAR, San Francisco Women Against Rape, but we all came about in the 1972. So when you think back on it, our movement in violence against women, or what they now so euphemistically call interpersonal violence, IPV, sounds like HPV, but it's not my preference to use that euphemism. I like to call it violence against women, men, and children, and LGBT folks. Matter of fact, I think when you call it violence and you talk about things like battery and rape, you present an urgency to a problem that the term IPV just doesn't address for me. But then I'm kind of old school. We were also far more radical in those days, as well as being intersectional. We didn't have lawyers, And so we were rather fearless in the actions we would take to end or intervene in violence against women. I remember going to Malcolm X Park and hearing a woman screaming, and all of a sudden we ran over to the park and we stopped a man from beating a woman. And then, you know, nowadays a lawyer would say, don't do that, you'll get sued, or what have you, where we had no hesitation. A woman screamed, we ran towards the scream, while everybody else was running away, because that was the radical nature of our feminism. We also did zap actions, which were kind of fun, and I'm not recommending that you do them. But let's say a victim reported an assault to us and yet didn't want to report to the police, which is, of course, the victim's right. Yet we could identify who the perpetrator was. Well, our zap action was about outing the perpetrator. So we would go to his job, start a picket, you know. If we found out where he lived, we'd start a picket. And I'm sure many lawyers would tell us not to do that nowadays. But we were much more focused on community accountability than criminal accountability, because the other concern we had, particularly after engaging with prisoners against rape, was how the anti-rape movement was becoming a feeder line into the prison industrial complex. And the same prison industrial complex had a likelihood of victimizing the victims as well as the violators. As a matter of fact, we see this over and over again, where laws that are designed to protect domestic violence victims end up being used against the victims. We had a case of Marissa Alexander in Florida a few years back. You may have heard of her case. Marissa Alexander's an African-American woman with three kids. She had a protective order against her husband. He showed up one day, her ex-husband. He showed up one day, threatened to beat her. She pulled a gun, fired into the air to threaten him, and the police ended up arresting her, and she got sentenced to 20 years in jail. Now, wait a moment. Isn't Florida the stand your ground state that let George Zimmerman off for killing Trayvon Martin, who was unarmed? Yet when a black woman tried to say, I stood my ground against someone I had a protection order against, she got sentenced to 20 years in jail. And so the intersection between the prison industrial complex and violence against women is not no small thing. It's not only perpetrators going, but victims going. We had to do a campaign on behalf of Marissa. She served 3 years of her 20-year sentence. But she should have never been arrested in the first place. You know, losing custody of her children, because she tried to defend herself from a batterer against whom she'd gone to court to get an order of protection. And so we didn't isolate violence against women from conversations around international affairs, like, as I said, apartheid or Central American solidarity work with Guatemala, El Salvador, Nicaragua. I'm actually disappointed that the current feminist movement, it feels much less globalized to me now than it did back in the 70s and 80s, because we spent a lot of time visiting other countries to see how they were handling violence against women, and networking with feminists in those countries. Some countries, I really wish we could have duplicated their campaigns, but for example, went to Italy. An Italian feminist, I don't want to make a stereotype, but they had a different way of dealing with men who batter. They took a baseball bat to their knees. I'm not going to even talk about where that might have come from, right? Obviously, that's not available to us. But at the same time, I bet you it was damn effective in stopping men from rebattering. I'm just saying. So I guess in hindsight, I have to ask the question, since we started this work in 1972, what have we achieved and what has changed and what has not changed? Let's bring us back to present time. I think one of the things that we achieved was establishing that violence against women, and I'm using women to talk about men, LGBT, on and on. I'm just using it as a verbal shorthand. We established that violence against women was wrong. Women who used to think that they deserved to get beaten now know that they don't have to. We know that children deserve not to be beaten or sexually assaulted. We've enacted all kinds of programs to protect young people, vulnerable people, the elderly. All of these came out of the movement to end violence against women, and we should be rightfully proud of these achievements. We've at least identified it as wrong. Violators no longer brag about beating up on their wives. You know, throw a few beers back at the bar and use the alcohol as an excuse for expressing violence at home. They no longer can do that. But obviously, we have not stopped violence against women from occurring, even though we have 2,000 rape crisis centers and domestic violence shelters across the country. Matter of fact, I have to digress for a minute. I'm somewhat pissed off that we have 2,000 rape crisis centers and domestic violence shelters across the country, largely because in so many ways they're one-dimensional. I spent the 1990s working against hate groups and hate violence, monitoring groups like the Ku Klux Klan and the neo-Nazi movement. I just met Howard Fineman. Where are you, Howard? Over there, where we shared some history in doing anti-fascist work back then in the 1990s while he was a civil rights lawyer and I was doing this monitoring work. I was probably the only black person going to Klan rallies professionally, which is a whole nother speech. But I bring that into the conversation because at the time, we were fighting for authorization of the VAWA Act, the Violence Against Women Act, and that was eventually passed in 1994. I pointed out how, amongst our thousands of rape crisis centers and domestic violence shelters, if a woman called me because she'd been a victim of racial violence or immigration violence, or homophobic violence, or any other number of violences that I could identify. If she called me and she needed a place to go, she was not eligible to be accepted into a domestic violence shelter because her violator was not an intimate partner. And so I was like, there's something wrong when we spend so much energy protecting or providing services to one category of women getting violated, and yet slam the doors on those who don't present the perfect victim for us. You know, what if the woman is homeless, an immigrant, experienced a hate crime attack? You know, might have been transgender. I mean, all of these things, none of our shelters, our services were designed to address. And so I got into a lot of trouble in the early 90s fighting for inclusion of other victims of violence in the Violence Against Women Act. Because some people thought it made it so broad that it would lose cogence, that it would not be enforceable. But for me, all I could see was who it left out. I was so, I mean, we spent a decade fighting for this bill, so I'm very proud that we got it and it got amended and all of that, but I'm always aware of who we leave out when we compromise for our legislation. Just like in the 80s, I fought for the Family Medical Leave Act and fought furiously against them only granting unpaid leave. Because women who cannot afford to not work for 3 months can't take advantage of the legislation. How many of us, if we didn't have income for 3 months, would be homeless? You know, and so the FMLA left out low-income vulnerable people. And in that same way, VAWA left out intersectionalized people. I don't know if I'm making any sense, but, you know, these are the kinds of things that in the future we need to fix. You know, so we've made violence against women, children, men, LGBT people wrong, but we have not offered a full menu of remedies and inclusiveness that should have, that should happen. But I am really proud of what I see happening in the 21st century. I've paid very careful attention. One thing about being in the violence against women's movement is that it's like the mafia. Once you're in, they never let you go. I mean, I left the Rape Crisis Center in 1982, but I'm still concerned about and focused on and working to end violence against women. It's in my blood. I can't not do this work. And one thing I'm really proud about is how the new generation of activists, particularly coming from campuses, are responding to violence against women. I mean, first of all, they gave us a term, rape culture, that did not exist before, that really crystallizes all those things. Kind of like the word microaggression, you know, it crystallizes all of those things that we weren't marking and recognizing as part of violence against women. The ubiquitous nature of devaluing women, that's part of the continuum of violences against women. They've also done a much better job with organizations like Insight, Women of Color Against Violence, of naming the violences that women are vulnerable to, like immigration violence, state violence, police violence, economic violence when someone controls your resources and you don't. Yeah, on and on and on, homophobic violence. And so now this new generation of activists, they see ending all forms of oppression as intimately connected to ending rape, domestic violence, sexual assault, sexual harassment, and all of that. And they've situated the struggle on college campuses trying to make best effective use of Title IX. So they now have both the VAWA and Title IX in their arsenal with which to combat this violence. And there's a whole lot of problems with Title IX. I mean, Title IX is good in terms of it's trying to provide protection. And for those of you who don't know, Title IX is a civil rights act that says basically that people deserve equal opportunity to get an education. And their way that they're able to use Title IX is to interpret it that says creating a sexually hostile atmosphere through rape culture, domestic violence, you know, transphobia and all of that denies people the opportunity to an equal education, which is a wonderful interpretation of what we need to advance our human rights movement. I'm going to talk about human rights in my closing, so let me keep on. Now, there are some problems with how campuses have interpreted Title IX, though, and what we're seeing is a really problematic mixture of what campus responsibilities are, students, faculty, and administrators, trying to intersect with the criminal justice system. And in fact, the criminal justice system provides fewer remedies and fewer rights than campus policies that are allowed under Title IX. And so campuses who genuflect to the criminal justice system are actually doing a disservice to their students. And so I invite you to read more on this. On the website attended to this event were some wonderful articles. I don't have them in front of me, but I really invite you to read the articles that were prepared for this event on the website that really speaks about the problems, particularly community colleges have in implementing Title IX. Because you have a greater responsibility at the community college level with fewer resources. But you have many more complicated factors to deal with. But I'm not going to enumerate those because you can read them. But at the same time, having Title IX is available to us is a wonderful victory, but it's also problematic. And probably the most problematic aspect I would highlight at this moment is how campuses are following a law enforcement model and demanding mandatory reporting of sexual assault. And that is not necessarily good for people who are victimized by sexual harassment and sexual assault on campuses. I mean, maybe it seems on the surface that, well, why not report? Well, the problem is that mandatory reporting, by definition, strips the victims of rights. The criminal justice system takes over. The victim doesn't have any protection over his or her privacy anymore. They cannot heavily influence the process that ensues because they're just a witness now. They're not the center of the process. And so it's a problematic thing. Even if you don't offer a critique of the prison industrial complex, even if you only center your concern around what do victims have and what rights do victims have, mandatory reporting is problematic because they lose control over their privacy, they lose control over their case. Matter of fact, it has an unintended consequence of causing many victims not to report to the campus level. Because they know if they're in a campus that has mandatory reporting to law enforcement, simply making the campus report is going to trigger law enforcement intervention, which many victims simply don't want. And so, unfortunately, campuses don't know they do not have to do it that way. It's a choice campuses are making to intersect law enforcement and Title IX. They don't have to. Title IX does not require it. But in many ways, campuses want to cover their asses, make sure everything is done according to the legal definition of what needs to be done, but in many ways that centers the campus in the middle of the lens and decenters the victim. You know, and so we're proud of having Title IX and the expansive protections that we have, but we're also concerned about it. Another concern of mine is when we talk about providing protections for people from all the different violences that could happen on campuses, we always seem to run into this debate around whether or not we are limiting free speech. And of course, there's a lot of haters out here who hate the liberal progressive values that campuses are offering and the education and all of those things. But I'm also concerned that we already live in a country that privileges the speech of people with power over everybody else's rights. And so when there's this blowback, well, you're attracting free speech when you tell somebody that it's racist to wear a Native American costume for Halloween or what have you. Again, you're protecting the privileged at the expense of the underprivileged. And I'm not just making this up. I was having dinner last night with some people, and I was explaining to them how peculiar our Supreme Court works when it comes to free speech and victims. Many of you may not remember this, but in 1992, there was a case before the Supreme Court called RAV, those initials, RAV versus St. Paul. And the case became before the Supreme Court because three white kids in St. Paul, Minnesota, objected to the fact that a black family had moved into their neighborhood. And so in protest, what they did was that they went to this black family's yard, set a cross in the middle of their yard, and then set it on fire. Now, most of us observing that case felt that that was a case of racial terrorism. I mean, what else do you call it? I mean, because obviously if they wanted to make a speech, they could have set the cross in their own front yard and burnt it. You know, but the fact that they went to this other family's yard and set the cross on fire was a little bit more than speech. We called it racial terrorism. Interestingly enough, though, but when the case wended its way through up to the Supreme Court said that was protected free speech. That these white teenagers had a right to express their resentment against this black family without even inquiring whether the black family had a right to be in their home free of racial threats. We see over, and whether it's neo-Nazis marching through a Jewish neighborhood in Illinois or whatever, we see over and over and over again the free speech claims trumping the rights of vulnerable people. And so my antenna always go up when the claim of free speech comes out to try to thwart us ending racist and sexist violence on campuses. Because we know who those claims privilege. We have a long judicial and legal history to address that. And I think campuses sometimes get their panties in a wad over the question. I also had the experience of watching a lot of campuses capitulate. For example, when somebody who's obviously a racist or an anti-Semite or whatever comes to campus, like David Duke coming to campus or somebody like that. David Irving is actually a better example. David Irving is a British man who insists that the Holocaust never happened. You know, which is kind of bizarre. That's kind of like someone coming to campus and insisting that the earth is still flat. Now, for some reason, campuses confused over free speech seem to think that they are compelled to give people like this a platform in which to articulate these bizarre theories. And I'm like, excuse me, but would you give a platform to someone that says 2 + 2 = 5 in the pursuit of academic freedom? You know, you have an obligation to approximate the damn truth, at least, not offer this fair and balanced bullshit that isn't fair and balanced, in fact. Because when you allow a David Irving to come to campus and insist that the Holocaust didn't happen, then you are ignoring the palpable injury to victims of the Holocaust and their survivors. You're perpetuating the Holocaust. You are not debating it. Yeah. And I never quite understood why campuses could not figure out. David Irving has the right to say whatever the hell he wants to say it, wherever the hell he wants to say it. Campuses have an obligation to not offer him a platform. There is a difference. No more than you would offer a platform, like I said, to someone who's insisting that the earth is flat. You know, those kinds of things. So when people talk about, well, you know, we don't know whether or not, you know, we should protect the free speech right of people who commit sexual assault or even veiled threats and those kinds of things, I'm like, it's amazing that we can't figure this out. Or is it we're choosing not to figure it out because we are protecting the privileged? There's that question. So one of the things that I really, really like about the modern movement is, as I said, they intersectionalize violence against women. I've been paying particular attention, since I'm a reproductive justice activist, to how reproductive violence presents itself in our society. For example, annually, 32,000 pregnancies result from rape. 32,000 people are pregnant resulting from rape. And yet in this pro-abortion, anti-abortion, pro-choice, pro-life debate, nobody's really asking the question about what about the rights of a woman not to be permanently tethered to her rapist? And for me, this is not an idle question, just a little bio here. At 14, I was incested by my cousin, who was 27. Married man, asshole, need I say more. At 15, I had a baby, his baby. And at that time, I had a choice on whether to give my son up for adoption or keep him. Now, I made the choice to keep my son. And I don't regret that. He's a wonderful kid. Well, he's 47 now, so he's not a kid. But I chose to keep him. But I also, with that decision, had the consequence of being tethered to my rapist for the entirety of my child's life. That was a choice I made. That is not a choice that should be imposed on people. And I'm not so sure, remember, I know for a fact that it compromised my relationship with my son because I loved him and hated his circumstances. I saw his father in everything he did. Yeah. And a child deserves unconditional love from their mother, not this compromised love you, hate you, want you, don't want you kind of ambivalence. That children smell, they detect it. And I tried to overcompensate for it, but also I had to have very frank and hard conversations with my child about his father. And it wasn't just me making it up. He ended up being, my son's father ended up being incarcerated for pedophilia. I mean, he had a pattern of doing this to his young relatives. So anyway, when I talk about the intersection of reproductive violence and violence against women, I'm not doing it from a theoretical point of view. I'm doing it from an experiential one. When I talk about why is it that 10% of the women who seek abortions have injuries to their genital areas long before they even come to the clinics? You know, why is it the most dangerous time for a woman in an intimate relationship may be when she's pregnant with a violent partner? You know, some of the Lacey Peterson stories and stuff like that. So we have to make those kinds of intersections. So in the few minutes left to me, I want to close by talking about human rights, because I described in my journey, I went from women's rights to civil rights to human rights. And I thought that was a pretty unique journey, because as I said, my first consciousness was around feminism and what had happened to me. I was lucky to go to the Rape Crisis Center and find that I was not alone. And after I left the women's movement, I went into the civil rights movement, working to end hate groups and violence, bigoted violence. And then finally, within the civil rights movement, I actually heard something that I had never heard before. My boss at the Center for Democratic Renewal, where I was Reverend C.T. Vivian, who had been the aide to Dr. Martin Luther King, the political director for Dr. Martin Luther King. And when I was talking to Reverend Vivian at one point, I said, you know, Reverend Vivian, when we ask people to give up hate, you know, what's next? And he surprised me by saying, well, you know, Martin never meant to build a civil rights movement. I'm like, what you talking about? Because down south where I live, we are told that it's Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, civil rights leader, like it's all one word. And you're disrespectful to cut any of it out. You know? So I knew that Reverend Vivian knew Dr. King very well, because he said, Martin. You know, but he said he never meant to build a civil rights movement. He meant to build a human rights movement. And this was in 1995, right after the Oklahoma City bombing. And I looked at Reverend Vivian and I said, I have no idea what you are talking about. And he actually went to his shelf and pulled out a copy of Dr. King's last Sunday sermon, March 31st, 1968, in which he called on us to build a human rights movement in the United States. And I have to say, I was dumbfounded, because I know I was probably spluttering, but I was saying, everybody told me he had a dream. Nobody told me he had a plan. And in that moment, I had my own kind of epiphany. And Reverend Vivian, Abdullahi Al-Naheem, who is a Muslim law professor at Emory University, Shulamith Koenig, who's an Israeli-American activist on behalf of Palestinians, the four of us founded the National Center for Human Rights Education, a Muslim, a Jew, a Christian, and an atheist. Talk about diversity. But anyway, that's when I became fascinated with a couple of things. First of all, why don't we know about human rights in the United States? This is a global framework that people have been using for six decades that is barely known in the United States. And I feel it's almost like a conspiracy. Matter of fact, I know it's a conspiracy. I'm not just Mel Gibson. In the 1950s, when the Universal Declaration of Human Rights had been ratified by the United Nations on December 10th, 1948, in the 1950s, our Secretary of State, John Foster Dulles, for whom Dulles Airport is named after, sent this cautionary memo to the president saying that we need to be careful about this human rights thing because it might agitate our Negroes. Now, I'm paraphrasing, obviously, but basically, there was this conservative backlash to the concept of human rights because it threatened the maintenance of segregation in Jim Crow. And that conservative backlash to human rights is intact today, where in 1979, President Carter signed the Convention on Eliminating All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, but the Senate has never ratified the Women's Human Rights Treaty. We are the only industrialized nation that has not ratified the Women's Human Rights Treaty. Why? Because they are appropriately afraid that if we actually had human rights into our law, we would use it. And so all of this stuff about sex discrimination and Title IX and violations would be in a whole nother playing field and under a whole new legal regime. And so we have conservatives who are opposed and have been for six decades to us using the human rights framework in our activism. But I want to read something from the World Conference on Women that was held in Beijing in 1995. The human rights of women include their right to have control over and decide freely and responsibly on matters related to their sexuality, including sexual and reproductive health, free of coercion, discrimination, and violence. This is the framework we should be using, in my opinion, because there's eight categories of human rights protections to which we are entitled. There are civil rights, the right to be treated as an equal to anybody in society, non-discrimination rights are civil rights. There's political human rights, freedom of speech, the right to vote, though we've recently learned that we don't have the rights to have our votes counted. So, oops. And there's voting disenfranchisement happening all across America. There's economic human rights, the right to have the economy managed in such a way that it meets the needs of a people. What a bizarre concept that is. I would argue that the Occupy movement drew careful attention to the fact that the economy is being managed to meet the needs of the 1%, not the 99%. There's social human rights, your human right to food, clothing, shelter, education. Oh, I need to stop at education, put a pause in it. Because I think that is why the 99% have been brainwashed into not thinking of education as a human right. Because if they taught us that education is a human right, how could they then charge us $50,000 a year for our human rights? There is a financial disincentive in including human rights education in our standard curricula. Yeah. Right now, our education profits the banks. And no one wants to interrupt that money train. Yeah, and so I just needed to pause there and say, you know, like I said, I don't have to be Mel Gibson to detect these conspiracies. They seem to be pretty obvious to me. And so fifth category is called cultural human rights, the right to practice your own religion, to speak the language of your need, to get services in the language of your need. So let's say every time you do a flyer in Spanish, you actually are a human rights defender. You may not know you're upholding people's human rights, but that's in fact what you're doing. Now, I didn't mention freedom of religion as a human right. I should also add as corollary, freedom from religion is also a human right. So I have the human right not to have someone else's religious views imposed upon my body. You know, and I felt that if we conducted the battle over reproductive justice as a human rights struggle, we'd get further along. Because those who oppose women's rights are talking about pro-life, and I'm talking about pro-human rights. And I think that's a much stronger and capacious moral argument to counter people who only care about life before it's born. When I'm talking about children have a right to food, shelter, education, health care, da-da-da-da-da-da-da, that they can't seem to get to. Yeah, so anyway, the sixth category is called environmental human rights, the right to a clean environment, to potable water, to non-toxic neighborhoods, on and on. Seventh category is called developmental human rights. These are rights demanded by what we call the developing world to develop their own natural resources. What a radical idea that is. Yeah. Whereas I would argue that most of the wars taking place in the world today are taking place because we're fighting over natural resources. For example, George Bush invaded Iraq because he couldn't explain how our oil got under his their sand. You know? The genocide in Darfur is over natural resources, on and on and on. And then the eighth category, which brings me full circle back to what I'm talking about in terms of violence against women, are called sexual human rights. The right to control if and when you marry, if and when you'll have sex, if and when you'll have children. My favorite, the right to sexual pleasure, is a human right. So you can tell your partner, you're not doing it right. You're a human rights violator. Which can make interesting conversation in the bedroom. You know, but anyway, all jokes aside, we have a right to bodily integrity, to freedom from violence, to freedom from coercion. And so I think if we move these conversations out of those narrow corridors of criminal justice and all that and into the fuller light of human rights, I think we could come up with different responses. And I didn't want to describe those categories of human rights as if they were finite, because I think new human rights will emerge as new social justice movements demand them. As a matter of fact, my grandson reminds me daily that the ninth category of human rights will probably be digital human rights. Because we are quickly approaching a time that if you are not digitally connected, you may be seen as subhuman. When your banking and your healthcare and your education are all digitally dependent. And so these are human rights. So in closing, I want to say that we who care about violence against women, who care about the enforcement of Title IX, who care about ending racism, homophobia, transphobia, all these issues that affect our ability to live lives of security, I think we need to become a wing of the human rights movement, the violence against women wing, for example, of the human rights movement, working against the anti-gentrification wing of the human rights movement, or the environmental justice wing of the human rights movement, or the gay rights wing of the human rights movement. We need to become a unified movement for our human rights against all those forces that would deprive us of our human rights. This is what Dr. King recognized March 31st, 1968. And we've yet to fulfill that promise. We've yet to live up to it. And so I'm really proud of what we've achieved in the movement to end violence against women. We've changed the world. I don't think that there's a country in the world you can go to where people are not working to end violence against women. But we've got a lot more to go. We have to figure out a different way to socialize people so that they do not think violence is a normal and routine response to difference. You know, I am appalled at what is happening with the presidency of Donald Trump. I mean, if you're not scared shitless, you should be, or your privilege is protecting you from the fear. I'm not quite sure how to call it. But people who are choosing not to engage in the political process with the threat of neo-fascism looming over America are morally lazy. That's the only way to describe it. You know, and probably privilege protected, because they can't figure out what they've got to lose with this rise of neo-fascism. And so, thank y'all for letting me come and talk to y'all today. I love talking about violence against women. I wish I didn't have to give any more talks on ending violence against women, but we've got a long way to go, but we've come a really long way, and I'm glad you let me share my last 45 years of a journey with you. Thank you.
Genevieve, I left about 5 minutes for questions.
Thank you. I left about 5 minutes for questions, and I have business cards for those who want to stay in contact.
Wow, I know you have a lot to think about here, but did you have a question?
Thank you. On the human rights piece, can there be significant progress on that front within the current capitalist structure? Just the theoretical question on that, because it sounds like a lot of the things you mentioned, it sounds like they're inherently, that capitalism is inherently going to be an obstacle for that.
Well, I would say that any economic system that doesn't center the needs of its people is going to be an obstacle. Because we found out through the collapse of the Soviet Union, while they prioritized economic, cultural, and social rights, they denied civil and political rights. And so under capitalism, we've got the prioritizing of civil and political rights while the denial of economic, social, and cultural. So, by definition, I'm not ready to make the case that we have to destroy capitalism to get to our human rights, because I don't see that as a viable charge. But I do say that we have to assert the inalienability of our human rights no matter what the economic system is, because it is very possible to construct another alternative economic system and still violate our human rights. Yeah, and so I center my desire, if I'm working under socialism, I have certain demands I'm gonna make of that system. If I'm working under capitalism, I have demands I'm made under that system. And now that we've transitioned into neoliberalism, the demands have changed, but my human rights have not. And the thing that I love about the human rights framework is its immense adaptability. Every human being has the same human rights, but because of our own intersectional identities, we all need something different to protect them. So you may acknowledge, for example, that a blind child has a right to an education, for example. You know, and recognize that that child has to have books in Braille in order to achieve the same human rights. You know, everybody has a right to the religion of their choice. But under this present circumstances, we're getting assaults on Muslims, particularly. That means that they need special protections, despite all the so-called Christians claiming that they're under attack and this kind of stuff by, you know, where people pee. I'm not ready to say that we have to destroy capitalism to get to human rights. I'm saying that we have human rights no matter what system we're living under.
Unfair, non-human rights criminal justice system. What is a more reparative justice, human rights way to do Title IX on community college campuses?
Are you asking me?
Yeah, just for one more, you know, concrete vision that you might have thinking about that, because Title IX is what we have that we're working with. How can we work with it more human rightsy?
Human rightsy, yeah. Well, first of all, I invite you to look up things like restorative and redistributive justice, because people within those movements are doing great work in coming up with community-centered alternatives to the prison industrial complex. And so I wouldn't be able to do them service by trying to quote that whole body of work. Redistributive and restorative justice are two ways. I went to Cuba, for example, and like I said, I've been to 60 countries looking at violence against women, and in Cuba, I found out that their most common way of dealing with domestic violence, because they had fears of reporting to the state, were to establish community councils and have people held accountable at the community level without any reference to law enforcement or the state. You know? And I like that model. Because generally people shamed within their own family and community, that's much more of a deterrent than any other I can think of in some ways. And so we need to be creative, inventive. Now, with Title IX particularly, I would ask people to really explore the opportunities offered by Title IX, as well as its limits, but its opportunities, because I see Title IX as offering more victim protection than the criminal justice system offers. For example, within Title IX, if a student experiences a sexual assault, the college has an obligation to create as safe an environment as possible for that student, like maybe redesigning classes so that they don't have to go to class with the perpetrator, moving them out of the dorm, or moving the perpetrator out of the dorm so that the student doesn't have to interact with the perpetrator. I mean, campuses have that power and those obligations. You won't find that in the criminal justice system. You know, because the criminal justice system is predicated on protecting the rights of the accused, not the victim. You know, and so, but I would invite you to look at other systems of healing communities. Because I don't think punishment is a healing strategy. You know, so we need to have healing communities. And I also don't think that everybody who commits violence is a natural born killer. We are socialized into violent responses. You know, kind of like this calling out culture that we have on campuses and stuff like that. We're socialized into violent responses. And so while I'm not letting people off the hook, I am also trying to be objective about what produces the violations. And I don't think it's just crazy people. Yeah.
I have a question. One more quick question. This is our last question.
Good morning, and thank you for your sharing and enlightenment. When you were talking about free speech on campus, my question is, when does free speech violate victims of that discourse, and what do community colleges do in an open, liberal education forum? How would we handle something like that?
Okay. Another body of work that I've been doing recently is trying to transform the calling out culture into a calling in culture that brings me into conversation with free speech all the time. And one of the things, the first thing that a campus must do is stop the harm. You can't even talk about a remedy if you haven't stopped the harm first. You know, let's just start with that. Stop the harm. So if someone's saying, you know, I'm in Atlanta, so somebody, a group of students, they're using the word Trump as invective now. You know, so they don't say the N-word, they say Trump. You know, having it serve as a metaphor for the N-word if you want to talk about being dangerous and stuff. And so at Emory, where I was working, you know, people were saying, well, we can't read Trump as a threat. And we're like, excuse me, yes, you can. When it's been used as a threat. If say, you know, if I walk up to you in a very loving voice and say, I'm going to slap the out of you, that's still a threat. No matter how loving my voice is, how apparently neutral my words were, you know, those kinds of things. So the first thing is to stop the harm. The second thing to intervention, I think, is to offer education, because I've got a feeling that I don't have the empirical data to back it up, that most people who create harm do so unintentionally. Now, there are people who create harm intentionally, too, so I'm not saying that's a strategy for them. But I see a lot of harm and brutality among students that's unintentional. You know, the student that walks up to me and say, do you wash your hair? I think it's lovely. I don't think that was an intent to hurt me. Though it may hurt to have someone ask, do you wash your hair? It happens so frequently, I've got a pat and response. Yes, I do. Do you? But still, you know, my response is going to be predicated on what I think the intent was. But the other thing is that free speech is indicated as a matter of the government not being able to impose speech regulations. Private institutions, the NGOs, the non, you know, we got a right to do whatever the hell we want to do in terms of protecting our brand, in terms of protecting our environment and stuff. And so we do have the right to say this speech will not be tolerated here. You know, we're not the government. Even if we get government funds, we are not the government. And the government's not going to withhold all of our educational grants because we decided some racist can't parade around our campus. You know, and so I think people need to learn more about who actually free speech is meant to restrict, i.e. the government. And really start with, let's do no more harm. And then come up with remedies from there. All right, thank y'all again for listening to me.